So I'll be drawing heavily on some of the brilliant scholarship of Barbara Fredrickson at UNC and Marty Seligman of University of Pennsylvania for our sermon today. I wanted to start off with a personal story, tell you about why I'm interested in hope, and talk a bit about burnout, which is the area of research I've been involved in for a while. Then I'm going to switch around and we're going to talk about brain imaging studies. Doesn't that sound exciting? Brain imaging studies. And then we'll talk about some shocking research, and then we'll end with the role of hope. Hopefully this will all make sense before we pick up our children from childcare. So for 25 years now, I have conducted research as an applied social psychologist. And for the past 10 years, my research and teaching focus has been on burnout, getting burned out. What causes it? How do you recover from it? And increasingly, about the positive emotions like hope, that are hard to grasp when you're struggling. More about these positive emotions in a bit, but as a quick appetizer, there are 10 of them. Joy is a positive emotion, cheerfulness writ large. Gratitude, showing appreciation for another person or another thing. Serenity, just being at peace with the world around you. Interest or curiosity, being engaged in the world. Pride, I was able to do this. What else might I be able to accomplish? Amusement, finding something funny, sharing a giggle with a confidant. Inspiration, could be academic or spiritual. You could be watching the Olympics and you think to yourself, that just makes me want to be a better person. Awe is a powerful, positive emotion. How many of you have been to the Grand Canyon and seen it with your own eyes? That's a lot of us, most of us. So how did it work? You walked up to the rim and you said, yep, there it is. Okay, let's get back in the car, kids, let's go. That's not how positive emotions work. You have to pause and take it in, just stare at it and recalibrate your understanding of the world. Everything that you understood up until that moment has to be kind of re-examined. That's the power of positive emotions like awe. And there's love. What a wonderful, powerful, positive emotion. And then, last but not least, hope, which has taken a new priority in some of the research that we do on burnout. Now, the grandmother, the fairy godmother of burnout research, her name is Christina Mosbach. She's a professor emeritus at UC Berkeley. She's a wonderful person. I've been very fortunate to meet many of the luminaries in this research space. And let me tell you, most of them are curmudgeons. They're awful to be around. You don't want to share a conversation with these people. They're awkward. But not Christina Mosbach. She's lovely. She's just amazing. She's such a kind, gracious soul. In psychology, we do research, but a lot of us in psychology, we're drawn to a particular topic, and we don't call it research, we call it me-search, because we're drawn to our own pathology, right? What does that say about me and burnout? But Christina Mosbach, if she were here, if I can channel her for a second, she would say, burnout is comprised of three pillars. There's three ways to get burned out, to feel burned out. The first one is called emotional exhaustion. That's where you feel overwhelmed or drained, or you're unable to meet the demands that are placed upon you in your current situation. With a quick show of hands, how many of you know someone who's been emotionally exhausted before? Anybody know someone who's been emotionally exhausted? Okay, great. Right? Now, how many of you yourself have ever been emotionally exhausted? Yes. Now, be honest. How many of you are aware of at least one person sitting next to you who is currently emotionally not as many takers on that one. All right. So that's the first one, emotional exhaustion. The second is, it's good if your partner sees you. All right, that's all I'm saying. It's good to be seen. The second way that you get burned out is depersonalization. That's where you grow callous towards others. You see other people as objects. They're not people, they're just things trying to take your time, take your energy. That's depersonalization. And then the third way that you get burned out, it's called an increased sense of inefficacy. You don't feel like you're good at what you do anymore. Those are the three ways that you can meet the criteria for burnout, according to Christina Mosbach. Now, Let me kind of give you, that sounds well and good, it sounds very academic, there's emotional exhaustion, depersonalization, inefficacy. Let me give you a simpler explanation, because I like to, this is how when my seven-year-old asks me what I did today, and you know, what is burnout, Dad? I said, this is how I explain it to her. Burnout, at its core, is the impaired ability to experience positive emotions like joy, like being interested in something, like finding something funny, like feeling hope. Burnout is the impaired ability to experience the restorative effects of positive emotions. Now, positive emotions, like hope, they act like engines, little engines that will recharge your batteries as your batteries get drained through other people, through situations, through life circumstances. They recharge our batteries. They give us a sense of purpose. Positive emotions are how we get to the point where we feel like we're making a meaningful difference in the world. I challenge you to think back on a time where you felt like you were making a difference and not find positive emotions in there somewhere. They're the building blocks that make us feel like we're doing a good job, feel like we're making a difference. The building blocks of a successful life. And burnout makes it hard to access these things that we build our successes on. But if you eliminate all the burnout in the world, it's all gone. There's no more emotional exhaustion. There's no more depersonalization. There's no more inefficacy. It's all gone. Is that really success? Just the absence of burnout? Or should we strive for more than just the absence of suffering and insist on flourishing, to insist on thriving? This is what led us in our research lab to investigate resilience, to start to hunt, to study, really study human resilience. And just like Christina Moslak found three pillars of burnout, we found two overarching pillars for resilience in our research. Now, there's probably more pillars, but these two pillars do a really good job of predicting and understanding what people are going through and what they're going to go through 2 years, 5 years, 10 years from now. The first pillar is called emotional thriving. Emotional thriving is where you say, I have a chance to use my strengths every day. I feel like I'm thriving. I feel like I'm making a difference. I often have something that I'm looking very forward to. I'm hopeful. That's thriving. Does that make sense? The other pillar is called emotional recovery. Emotional thriving and emotional recovery. Emotional recovery is this whole idea of bouncing back. Take one on the chin and you're back to do it again, right? I can adapt to events in my life that I can't influence. That's recovery. My mood reliably recovers after frustrations and setbacks. I can always regain a positive outlook despite what happens in my life. I always bounce back quickly after difficulties. That's recovery. Make sense? So one is thriving and one is recovery. All right, here's where it gets kind of interesting. The skills for thriving and the skills for recovery are not the same. In fact, just because you're good at one doesn't make you good at the other. They're two pieces of our ability to really flourish. And our positive emotions work differently for the two pillars. In fact, if you want to thrive, the positive emotions that really go into thriving are things like awe. Finding things amazing, being interested in the world around you, that goes into thriving. If you want to focus on recovery, the positive emotions that are purely recovery, they really help to refill your recovery bucket. Things like pride and serenity, feeling at peace with the world around you. Now, our negative emotions, things like anger and fear, sadness, especially things like embarrassment, feeling ashamed or feeling guilty, those are negative emotions that really make it hard to recover. They're definitely related to our ability to bounce back. Feeling stressed, feeling sad, feeling guilty, feeling angry makes it harder to recover. But there's a couple of emotions that actually help with both your thriving and your recovery. A few years ago, we did a sermon on gratitude. Gratitude is one of those emotions that helps with your thriving and helps with your recovery. Inspiration helps with your thriving and your recovery. Joy helps with your thriving and your recovery. But the one that pardon my word, trumps them all, is hope. A little bit of hope does a big job of refilling your ability to thrive and refilling that gas tank and your ability to recover. Hope. In fact, would you guys like to do a little experiment? Would you could jump in being guinea pigs for just a moment? Yeah? All right. I'll get you to sign your human subjects consent form. So do me a favor. Take a moment to just gently lower your gaze and close your eyes just for a moment. And now, as you slowly open your eyes with a soft gaze, begin to look around the room. What do you notice? If you're listening to the recording, maybe you're in your living room or your car or your bathroom or you're walking, but if you're here in the sanctuary, just look around. Look out the windows. Look at the ceiling. Look at the back of the person's head in front of you. What do you notice about your current circumstance, your current situation? Are you safe right now? Are things awful right now in this very second? Take a moment to reflect on what is going well right now as you just look around the room. Taking the time to notice in this way can ignite the inner glow of gratitude that enlivens the eyes and softens your face with a just noticeable smile. Negative emotions like anger and fear, they tell us that something is wrong. They make you want to escape or to hide or to attack. They narrow what you notice about the world. They limit your options to deal with the situation. Positive emotions are different. Positive emotions like hope, they tell us that everything is fine. They tell our bodies that things are going to be okay. Positive emotions make you want to go out and play, explore, socialize, broaden your options and abilities to deal with the situation. Does that make sense? Negative emotions limit you. Positive emotions open you up. So far, so good? All right, hold on to that thought of positive emotions for a second. Hold on to hope in the back of your mind for just a minute, because I want to introduce another piece. Brain imaging studies. Functional magnetic resonance imaging. That sounds pretty complicated. Anybody ever been in an fMRI before? These big metallic donuts, big magnets. You get to ride in there and then they shoot these magnetic waves through your noggin. There are literally thousands of fMRI studies where we ask people to lie in a great big donut and we instruct them to do various tasks like mental arithmetic. Count, starting at 500, count backwards by sevens. And then we look at what parts of their brain light up when they do this. We have them do complicated anagrams. Or we give them moral dilemmas. Think about moral dilemmas. Like, name your top 10 reasons why Trump is a moral leader. And look at what part of the brain lights up. Now, in doing this, you always have to run a control group. Are you familiar with what a control group is? There's one group that you're doing a test on, another group that you're not doing a test, but you have to like run them through a similar situation. So what do they do with the control group? You ask the people in the control group to just lie there and don't do anything while they're laying in the donut. Just lie there, don't do anything. And the results of these thousands of fMRI studies are remarkable. It turns out that what lights up when you're asked to just lie there. Now, we're just looking at the control groups across thousands of studies. If you're asked to just lie there and don't do anything, what happens in your brain is uniform. It's so uniform, in fact, that it's called the default circuit of the brain. All these different studies, if you're just lying there, it's the same thing for everybody. It's also the same circuit that lights up if I ask you to imagine the future. If I say, what do you think you're going to eat for lunch today? Guess what part of your brain lights up? The default circuit of the brain. looking forward to something, daydreaming. They're the same as the default circuit of the brain. We are constantly looking forward. That's where our brain goes if we're doing nothing else. We are creatures of the future. So do me a favor, audience participation. Everyone take a hand for just a moment. Take one hand and put it on your forehead for just a moment. Put a hand on your forehead. All right. And the part of your brain that's behind your hand right now, the prefrontal cortex, go and put your hand down. The prefrontal cortex, the forebrain here, is about, it's all about predicting the future. It is the engine of the future. There are many therapists in the audience today. Therapy is usually focused on the past and the present. But if we look at depression and anxiety, these are ways of thinking about the future. Does it make a difference? Why should I get out of bed today? It's not going to get any better. Depression. Oh no, tomorrow's coming. It's going to be worse than today. Anxiety. Does that make sense? Depression and anxiety are problems of the way we look at the future, and we are constantly looking at the future. In prospective psychotherapy, you start with your thoughts about the future, and you work your way back to the present and then to the past. Now remember, depression is preeminently that the future is, bad. When Reverend Tom asked me to do this, he said, end on time. He said, try to make them laugh. And he said, don't curse. So, I'll just say, depression is essentially that the future is bad. That wasn't what I had written in my notes. But we are, all of us, we are born yesterday. We are creatures of this constant future that we're envisioning in our heads, consistently constructing these new futures. We are not chained to the past. What happened to us as children, child abuse, yes, it's related to your neuroses and your pathology as an adult. It's a statistically significant but relatively weak effect. Do you know what's even stronger to your current mental state? It's what happened last month. A divorce, a promotion, you bought a new car. This is much stronger in predicting our current well-being. New car smell. So the default of the brain is just thinking about the future. Does that make sense? Let's go forward. I want to talk about it. It's going to get technical from here. Marty Seligman and his colleagues in the 1960s and 1970s did a series of shuttle box experiments. Now, this is where you take a box, and there's a divider in the box. You put a dog in the box, and there's a hurdle in the middle. And one of the sides of the box is electrified, and the other side isn't. This is what I meant by shocking research. Really sad. This is sad, but this is how we learned a lot about depression, is through these animal studies. And there's a speaker in the box, and if the speaker plays a tone, boom, that's to warn the dog that it's about to get shocked. And the dog can learn that if it jumps over the hurdle in the middle, it can go to the safe side of the box where it can avoid the shock. Does that make sense? You can learn that you can control the situation. That's the first scenario. The second scenario is not quite as pretty. This is where they play a tone, boom, the dog jumps over the barrier, but they get electrocuted on the other side too. Does that make sense? And over a series of trials like this, you can teach the dog to be helpless. They can learn that nothing they do matters. Isn't that awful? That's actually probably the best, if not one of the best models that we have for depression. That's what happens when we can't envision that anything we do matters. Why try? Now the shuttle box studies taught us something interesting. 5 out of 8 dogs that go through this, and they've run many, many dogs through this, but 5 out of every 8 dogs that do this, on average, they become helpless. 5 out of 8. They see the situation as permanent, as pervasive, and as personal. 5 out of 8 humans do as well. They call it the 3 P's. It's permanent, that means it's never going to change. It's pervasive, it affects every area of my life, my marriage, my kids, my neighbors, my work, everything. And personal, must be my fault. Does that sound familiar? Nothing I do matters, why should I try? Now if you look at the bottom quartile pessimists in the world, if your outlook is one of pessimism, and by the way, that's not a death sentence. If you're pessimistic, you can actually change to become more optimistic through practice. If you're in the bottom quartile of pessimism, that's the equivalent, the health equivalent of smoking 2.5 packs of cigarettes a day. That's what it does to your life expectancy. Now, we said 5 out of 8 dogs and people, they become helpless, but 3 out of every 8, they can't be made helpless. You can shock them, you can do anything, and they're like, well, this sucks right now, but it's just right now. These are extreme optimists. They see hardships in life as temporary. They say, I can do something about this. It isn't my fault. This is what therapy teaches us. The situation I'm in, this is temporary. I can do something about it, and it's not my fault. The two overall responses to hardship are despair and hope. In despair, your fear and uncertainty can turn into stress, which can morph into hopeless sadness, which can then breed shame. That's an awful lot of negative emotions. If I'm feeling sad and ashamed, why would I reach out to connect with others so that our possibilities for these genuine and authentic and restorative interpersonal interactions with others, they're lost? All because we go in this downward spiral. But hope is different. If that's your response, hope acknowledges the negativity. It sucks to be shocked. But you see it with clear eyes. Hope opens the gate to an upward spiral that empowers you to bounce back from hardship and to emerge even stronger and more resourceful than before. Now, whether it's animals or people, when they're given uncontrollable events, electric shocks, loud noises, whatever, sociopath for a boss, lots of bad things can happen. They developed what came to be known as this learned helplessness, which was characterized by being passive, by giving up. It also was characterized by panic and anxiety. It was also characterized by being stupid. If you teach someone to be helpless, they become stupid. They have trouble seeing that they can do something about a situation. Now, the last part of the sermon this morning, I'll just say right now, I'm not sure that I even understand this. But I'm going to tell you what it's called and how to pronounce it so you can Google it when you go home. Can you repeat after me? Dorsal? Raphae?
Raphae.
Nucleus?
Nucleus.
Dorsal raphae nucleus. All right, that's a structure deep here in the brain stem that if you turn it on with electricity or with chemicals, it is necessary and sufficient to cause the helpless reaction in rats, in dogs, and in people. This is where helplessness comes from. This is where the reaction comes from anatomically in the brain. If you turn it off, if you anesthetize that part of the brain, you cannot learn to be helpless. You'll continue to try. You won't give up. As it turns out, this is the default response to mammals to prolonged troubles. The dorsal raphae nucleus is the machinery that we use if bad things occur. The dorsal raphae turns on and you start to see helplessness and panic. This is the anatomy of chronic anxiety and chronic depression. That's kind of exciting. We found the cause of depression. We haven't found the cure yet, but more on that in a second. Now, the last complicated part of the morning. Up here in the prefrontal cortex, there's the ventromedial prefrontal cortex that has a set of discrete circuits that are designed to turn off the helpless circuit in the back. Up here, we have the ability to turn this off. This circuit up here is necessary and sufficient for not being helpless. If you turn on that circuit when animals are helpless, when you're shocking them, for example, they don't learn to be helpless. If you anesthetize the circuit when the rats or the dogs or the people are doing something that does matter, like they are jumping over the hurdle to escape the shock, they don't learn. So the good news is we found the cause. And even though this circuit is hard to get to, there's no way to easily stimulate the circuit right now. But within 10 years, in many of our lifetimes, certainly in our children's lifetimes, The resolution of these imaging techniques would be adequate so that we can isolate that one part of the brain, hit it with some magnetism, hit it with some electricity, and turn it off, so that we don't become helpless, so that we don't become anxious, so that we don't become depressed. So I am optimistic about the future of research on hope. Now, in ending, a recent meta-analysis, this is a study of a whole bunch of different studies, they found that hope and optimism consistently and pervasively was associated with less chronic pain, with higher T-cell counts, so you have better immune system functioning, you don't get sick as often, you don't stay sick as long, lower blood pressure, and lower mortality. Who couldn't use a little bit less mortality in their lives? Now, the opposite of depression is not happiness. Many of us think, oh, if I could just be happy, if I could just be happy. I want to ask you to reframe that here, the last part of our morning. The opposite of depression isn't happiness. The opposite of depression is hope. And the good news is that hope is a muscle that we can make stronger. It's not a personality style that you're sentenced to when you're a child. It is something that you can change. You can practice. You start by going out 3, 4, 5 years into the future. What's it going to be like then? Are you going to be happier then? Are you going to be healthier then? And then you go back to 1 year in the future. And then you say, what about 6 months? What about 6 weeks from now? What about tomorrow? And as you work your way back, it's easier to envision a better future the further out you go. But with practice, you strengthen the muscle so that just thinking about this evening, you expect to be, and you will be, happier, and you will be healthier. You all heard the proverbial glass being half full or half empty? What practicing hope does for us is that you don't see the glass as half full, you don't see the glass as half empty, you look around and you say, I notice a water pitcher standing right there behind the glass, and I can use it to fill up the glass all the way to the tippy top. It's about noticing. Hope is a muscle. Blessed be.